evening, everyone, and welcome to Beyond Focus TV. My name is Angie Daniel, and I am the hostess of the show. Tonight's show, we have with us Mr. Gary Pierre-Pierre. He is the founder of the Haitian Times. We're going to take a short break. We'll be right back so I can introduce him to you. Welcome back. We are here with Mr. Gary Pierre-Pierre. Welcome.
Well, thank you, Angie. It's a pleasure for me to be here.
Well, the pleasure is all mine. You're making me a little bit nervous because I know that you host your own show on the CUNY Network. So I, you know, it's like a journalist, right? A real journalist in front of me. So it's like, I'm a bit, you know.
Well, don't be nervous. There's no reason to be nervous. We're having a conversation.
We are. But I kind of like really like your thoughts because I think part of what I wanted to find out, like when I found out that I was going to interview you, I wanted to know, how do you create the concept of where you came from to where you are right now? For example, I know that, you know, you used to work for the New York Times. So can you tell us a little bit about the personhood behind the New York Times that created the Haitian Times?
Well, it's a long travel.
Yes.
Well, I was born in Haiti. I grew up in New York, in New Jersey. Then I went to college in Florida, studied economics and history. Well, I always loved journalism. I worked for a school newspaper in college. And I was the editor-in-chief when I left. When I graduated from college, I joined the Peace Corps, spent 2 years in West Africa, lived in Togo and Benin. And then after I left the Peace Corps, I went back to Florida to start my journalism career. I worked in Central Florida at the Lakeland Ledger. And then I got a job at the Fort Lauderdale Sun Sentinel, where I spent 3 years there. And then the New York Times came calling. They hired me, and I spent 8 years there covering everything from Africa to Haiti, New York, different beats. And then in 1999, I don't know what got into me, I decided that I wanted to start my own newspaper.
Yeah.
So I launched the Haitian Times. Well, what got into me was that I saw that the Haitian community was going through a transformation.
Mm-hmm.
We had always felt that we were an exile group, meaning that at one point in our life, we would go back to Haiti when everything got to be all good.
Yeah.
Well, over the years, things have gotten worse to some extent, and we've gotten older, and the idea of going back to Haiti permanently kind of faded into the background. And so then you see Haitians started getting involved into politics, and we've gotten involved into the mainstream life. And so I felt that we were no longer an exile group, we were an immigrant community.
Can you explain to me, like, I'm going to come back to the point that I wanted to make in terms of the newspaper itself. But it's interesting how you talked about it. I know I read in one of your pieces that you explained the difference between being an exile and being a community base. So, like, what is the difference between those?
Well, when you think about it, when Haitians live, when we first got here, everybody was focused on overthrowing Duvalier and going back to Haiti. So you were an exile. You came here not because you wanted to be here, but you had to be here. You couldn't live in your country. So that's where we were.
Okay.
And even though as we grew, we always came here not to stay, but to make a life for ourselves, get some money, and then go back. That's an exile group. Well, when you're an immigrant group, you came here, you lay down the roots, and you want to be here. This is your home. Although you have ties to your ancestral home, but you want to be here. I would say now Haitian Americans want to be here.
Okay.
We have kids, we have mortgages, we have car notes, we have bills. We can't go back. We're not going back.
Okay.
And if we do go back, it's for a moment, and then we come back anyway. This is where home is.
This is where home is.
Exactly.
This is our home base.
So I think every sort of like community needs different type of media.
Okay.
While there were two Haitian newspapers then, but I felt they were still exile newspapers. They were not community papers.
Okay.
They didn't talk about the school system. They didn't talk about the healthcare system.
Yes.
They didn't talk about the political system. And so that's why I started the Haitian Times to do that.
Okay. I am so glad that you brought it. Two things that you actually did. One of the things that I remember when I first saw it is that it was purely in English. And it was distributed like regular newspapers.
Yes, it was.
Actually, you didn't have to go buy it at the corner store, specific Haitian stores. This was a newspaper, a regular newspaper. So I thought, it's like the daily news.
This is one of the benefits of having worked at the New York Times. Yeah. I met the president of the distribution company at the New York Times who decided that he was going to distribute the newspaper for me. So that's how that came about.
Knowing what Haitian thinks about, like, when you work within certain companies, because I used to work for a really big company, and when I left it, everybody thought I was crazy. I just want to understand, how did you sell that idea to your family that I'm going to leave the New York Times, because New York Times is New York Times.
Yeah, it's a mecca.
And this yeah.
is a, well, the thing about it, my wife is not Haitian.
Mm-hmm.
She's American. And so it's not as much of a shock to her because she's comfortable.
Okay.
Whereas if, let's say, my wife was Haitian, her parents wouldn't even allow that to happen.
Yeah.
Because it's like, you've made it this far and now you want to go back to the Haitian community.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's not going to happen. But because my wife is not Haitian, I think that allowed me to do that. Otherwise, it would have been impossible.
Okay. I remember reading one of the things that we talked about is how you, as a Haitian person, made a difference within the community in terms of how you voice the opinion. How does it feel for you to be among the group that's considered the eyes and the ears of Haiti?
Well, it's something, it was part of what I wanted to do as well with the newspaper, because I think a lot of times, even the people that I would interview for the New York Times, I sort of came away a bit embarrassed.
Okay.
By the comments that they made, by the way they comported themselves, and for the ideas they were articulating. I think it was simplistic. And I felt that the new generation needed a spokesperson. One of many. I wasn't the spokesperson by no means. There were other people speaking out on behalf of the community. But I think that you needed somebody to do that, and to do that in sort of eloquent and articulate who we are. A lot of times, some of the comments, we're shrill, and watching them as a journalist, I felt like...
Do you mean like the general public, or you mean the Haitian community?
Some of the leaders of the Haitian community who were sought after to comment about Haiti, and I felt that was lacking as well. I really do.
So you're thinking it's a lack of education in terms of like a cultural education?
It's not really a lack of education. I think these people are very educated.
No, I meant like cultural education.
Exactly. It's just that understanding the American media. How do you answer a question? And all this, you got to be media savvy.
It's so cool to actually hear that, because I'm always telling people that there's a different, like being able, for example, like we have this whole police stop and frisk, right? Mm-hmm. I talk about this all the time. And I'm always talking about like if the police were to understand the concept of the people that they are serving, I think the whole police department position situation would have been different. Wouldn't you say?
Well, definitely. You have to understand the culture in which you operate.
Where you at.
Yeah.
So not understanding how American journalism work, or understanding the questions that are asked of you, you would give your own idea of what you think it is. Right?
Exactly.
All right. I have a second question for you. We're going to take a short break. We'll be right back. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back. Welcome back. If you're just tuning in, you are watching Beyond Focus TV with Mr. Gary Pierre from the Haitian Times.
Yes.
Before we took a break, we were talking about like understanding culture. And one of the things that I know you're very involved in is getting people to know where they're at, the culture of where they came from. I think I say it all the time, like, we are very proud people. We are very proud of who we are, where we've been, and how far we are going. I know that you are part of the Creole Fest. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, Creole Fest, we created Creole Fest at the Haitian Times. Mm-hmm. Part of our business plan starting the newspaper was to have a really strong presence in cultural affairs. That means music, art, and cuisine. Mm-hmm. And to me, Creole Fest brings all of that together. We have the music, we have the art and crafts vendors, and we have the cuisine of Haiti. This is basically a taste of Haiti. It's an event that is as near and dear to my heart as the newspaper itself. Okay. And we started it a year right after we launched the paper. Creole Fest was there. And we have remained consistent. We are, I would say, without a doubt, the best organized Haitian event in the world. And I don't mean that very...
literally, you mean...
No, I mean that.
Yeah.
And I don't mean that in an arrogant way.
Yes.
I think it's a fact. Everyone will tell you that. In fact, we just had the festival on June 24th. Because we have tough economic times, mm-hmm. things are really tough for the festival. But at the end of the day, people came away with a good sense of what the festival was about. We promise every act that we humanly can deliver, and we do that. It's a good vibe, it's a good event, and we're really proud of that. Because when I was growing up in New York, the only time Haitians got together was when we had to protest for the United Nations against Duvalier or something. That was only
I remember the AIDS walk.
Well, that was way before, way after. I mean, I'm talking about the 70s when I was a kid, 80s, early 80s, when, you know, it was in front of the United Nations, or sometimes there were some soccer games.
Okay.
But that was even later than that. But when I was really 11, 12 years old, that was nothing. And I remember the few events were a huge success, but you didn't have the wherewithal at the time for people to organize these things. And this is something that I filed in the back of my head. And when I got involved in the Haitian community, I was determined to bring an event that these kids who are coming now, you know, when they go away to college, when they come back, they'll remember that as part of their culture.
I mean, understanding the aspect of the culture itself, would you say that it was something that was indebted in you? Or do you, would you think that it's your aspect of how you think we should look at culture, or how we think as Haitians we should make ourselves seen?
Well, we have to, in fact, you know, if you don't, the power to define is the power to control. We have to define ourselves. Too often people have been defining us, who we are, AIDS, all these other stuff, voodoo. Yes. It's all fine. We humans, we have AIDS and we practice voodoo. That's fine, but that's not all we are. Yeah. We have a great music scene in the Caribbean. We have a great art scene. And so these kids growing up need to understand that. And this is part of what I was. I was fortunate enough to have parents who have, you know, given me that sense. And so I'd like to share what I've gotten with the community at large. Because I got a classical American education, meaning that, you know, you have to give back to your community.
Yes.
You know, so what is given to you, you must give back. Mm-hmm. Because I don't know how I got to the New York Times.
Okay.
I mean, was I the best writer in that area? I don't think so, but somehow I got there. So I have an obligation to really do something beyond just getting there. And I think working and giving back to, in my community, was part of that. And the Creole Fest is a huge component of that.
Okay, quick question on the top of your head. I was just thinking, how important do you think culture is to the humankind?
I mean, that's what, you know, that's the essence, that's the heart of who we are. That's our soul. Without culture, without music, without food, you can't live, first of all, without food. But I mean, I love food. I eat all kinds of food. And so I think food is what people gather around. You know, every time there's a big gathering, you gotta have food. Music, I mean, you know, without music, I think people will be miserable.
Okay.
Without art, you'd be miserable. And that's why it pains me sometimes when I see high schools are cutting back on music. And other art and crafts classes, and we shouldn't, because music is too important to our lives.
Well, I don't just think it's music. I think, like, one of the things that I, as Haitians, that we do a whole lot of, and we also are lacking, because part of what I want to do is to let people understand, like, there's this whole big notion of jazz, Haitian jazz now. It was always in our culture. We just didn't talk about it. Haitian art, it was always in our culture. It's like right now we have a new generation and we're not making that transition of transforming, of transporting what we know as Haitians and then letting them get that aspect of it. Except that, you know, like if you have kids that are born here, you're like, oh, they're American born and they're not really Haitian. But yet, if you create those two cultures, you close in the gap. Where a young Haitian that was born here and a Haitian that came from Haiti and they understand each other, we can create a better world, a better system of life. I mean, for me, that's just the aspect of it. Like, understanding the Creole Fest, getting people to know who we are, like you said earlier, it's like we can define ourselves instead of people defining us as a group of people. We can come out and say, this is where we are, this is who we are, this is what we belong, this is what we believe in, this is where we belong, instead of letting people understand that, oh, you know, they're Haitians and then they have the needs. So let's go back to the aspect of Haiti. Mm-hmm. I know that you're doing great works in Haiti. What are you doing in Haiti right now?
Well, I mean, the work that I do in Haiti is reporting. Mm-hmm. I mean, basically, after the earthquake, right after that, I was, like everyone else, really touched and shocked and felt that, you know, we needed to do a lot. And the way I did was reported the hell out of the story. Mm-hmm. We did tons of stories. We really brought it to another level. We pushed our mainstream colleagues to look at Haiti differently. Okay. I mean, did we succeed 100%? No, because they bring their own biases, whatnot, to the story. But I think they had a choice. They had good example to follow. And this is what we do as a newspaper. That's what we wanted to do with everything we do. We raise the professionalism of what we do. You know, sometimes the struggle with us is that I think we wanted to, we were in a hurry because there were so many holes that needed to be filled when we felt that we could fill all of them. We realized that it's not possible. Mm-hmm. We're just one entity and there are other elements that have to be at work, that have to play their role, and we can't be all things to all people. Okay. Because this is a marathon and we can't sprint. We have to pace ourselves, and this is where we are right now.
Okay, cool. I like that. Okay. All right, we're going to take a short break. We'll be right back. Welcome back. We are here with Mr. Gary Pierre. He is the founder of the Haitian Times. We are here talking about the Creole Fest, the impact of it, the understanding of it, and what it means for our culture. Earlier, we were talking about like how it is that you got involved. But I understand that there's a difference. It used to be a paid event. Mm-hmm. Now it's a free event.
Yeah, it's been free for the last 2 years. Well, the reason is very simple. When we started the festival, we had Wingate given to us. Mm-hmm. Where the previous park commissioner gave us a waiver where we could charge people.
Okay.
Well, he retired 2 years ago.
Okay.
And so the new leadership decided they were not going to keep that waiver. And either we were going to pay an exorbitant amount of money to the parks department,
okay,
or we could do it for free. Mm. And I decided, okay, let me do it for free because that way I could get sponsors.
Okay.
And then we'll do a different type of event. The first year, everybody, nobody believed that the festival was free because we had all the top bands. We had Jakud, New Look, Deceit, you name it, we had it. They said, there's no way we can have all these bands for free. Well, it was
sponsored.
Yeah, exactly. And so people didn't get there until 6-7 o'clock.
Wasn't it like a 3 o'clock event?
Oh, yeah, exactly. Yeah. So because they were waiting when the top bands got on the stage to see if we were going to charge them at the gate. And so, needless to say, our sponsors and our vendors who came
were not too
they're not too happy because people didn't come. So I was shocked because I thought that over the years I had, you know, earned my credibility and reputation. Yes. And it was nothing because Haitian cynicism
overcome everything.
That's prime. It's no matter what I told them, it was not true. They were not going to see it because in their mind, how can I do this for free? What's the scam?
What's the catch?
Yeah. And I'm like, no, I get sponsors. I get vendors. You come, you know, at a decent time because I have good acts performing throughout. You enjoy yourself and then you go home. Well, it was not that simple.
Okay.
And this year again, they came. They came very late. And one of the things that we're trying to do is to really give up-and-coming bands a chance.
An opportunity.
Because the promoters won't put them at any battle.
Yeah.
Because they don't have fans behind them.
Exactly.
They don't have a name.
It would be a waste of money.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so here we are trying to say, okay, we could do it very simple. Take 5 top bands, start the event at 6 o'clock, finish at 11, and then I'll go home happy. But I think it will really shorten and cheapen what the whole thing, the spirit of the festival.
Yeah.
It's a place where we can really engage ourselves. It's not a concert.
Okay.
It's a festival.
Okay.
Where we come in and mingle, we hang out, and we have a good time. We meet people we haven't seen during the whole winter when we're all inside. Or we just like rushing to the train station or to our cars because it's freezing outside. So when we come out, we have an opportunity really to mingle. And so I'm really urging people to think about it because we've given them everything we possibly can give. So what is it it's going to take to get them out early?
So do you advertise it as a free event? Because like
there's no other way for me to advertise it.
No, because if they're not coming in at a certain time,
it's funny because when it was paid, we had people there early around 1 or 2 or 3, but now it's free, people refuse to come early. But they're killing it for the new bands.
Yeah, because you thinking that they don't want to see the earlier act, is that what it is?
Yeah, I suppose.
All right.
I suppose. Or they think, people have told me, oh, it's kind of hot in the park. Well, it's hot inside the house, too.
Yeah.
Bring the kids out.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you can bring the idea of getting volunteers, for example, like, I watching a show like this, if someone would like to volunteer within the Creole Fest next year, because I know you said you have it every June, right?
Mm-hmm. So Last Sunday of June. In 2013, it'll be June 30th.
June 30th. For example, if I wanted, a person like myself would love to volunteer. Whom can we get in touch with?
Well, they can go on our Facebook page, Creole Fest, on our Facebook page and send us a message. We usually look into that around April. Okay. That's when we start getting a list of volunteers together. And so that's essentially it.
Okay.
But we really want people to understand that this is not a scam. We're not trying to pull a fast one on them.
Want to bring awareness, cultural awareness.
And just like you have free festivals and all over New York City.
We have it in, like, I think every Monday at Wingate Park, Monday night.
That's the Martin Luther King concert series. You have it in Prospect Park, Central Park.
And so we're
doing it. We used to be paid, but now I can't charge. Okay. That's why I wish I could charge.
Maybe if you were to charge, like, well, you can't charge it.
I can't charge, and I don't want to do it on the side because
it wouldn't make sense.
I'm too arrogant to do something like that. If I get caught, I wouldn't know.
I love the way you said that. Yeah, I mean, at least you own up to it. Like, you're too arrogant for that. But in every show, I think at the end of the show, there's an aspect of what's your main focus for doing the show. So what would be the one thing you would want the community to understand or take from the show?
Well, you know, I want people to get engaged. I think the Haitian community is not engaged enough. We're distrustful of each other. We always question people's motive. I know that there are people who are not up and up, but you know, you have to learn to trust. You have to look at the person's track record, what they've done over the course of the years, and judge that person for what he or she has done, and not what all Haitians, you know, because we are Haitians, but we're not all like each other. I mean, there are people who are honest, people are doing good work, people want to do better, and then we need to recognize those people and support them. I think there's a lack of support. We are too focused on the problems of Haiti and not focusing on the problems of the Haitian community.
As we are here, right here. And you know, like you said it earlier, we have a home base here. If you have a home base, you should be involved within your home base. Get it going. You know, like we talk about culture, we talk about like the involvement, for example, the whole Creole Fest, bringing out your culture. And I mean, for me personally, I think there are certain things that I get involved in, not so much because I'm like, okay, I want to be involved in it. I just want to see what tomorrow is going to bring. Like, how can we change our lives? How can we change the way where we live at? How can we change the people that we encounter on a regular basis? I mean, we are probably one of the most differentiated group of people within New York City. And we're doing it to ourselves. It's not because we don't have people who can represent us. We're just doing it, like you said earlier, we distrust each other. We don't talk about our real problems. But it's not just a Haitian community. It's a cultural thing that's right here within us that we're not taking advantage of.
And we need to change that.
Okay, part of our second segment, or maybe the next show that we have, is how can we take ourselves from this aspect of our humanhood to the better of tomorrow.
Well, that's where we live.
We can change that. Well, thank you for bringing
it. Well, my pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you for coming out. This is the end of our show. I hope you enjoyed our conversation. Next year, if you have a chance, and if you'd like to volunteer, you can go on the Creole Fest Facebook page, right?
Yes, Facebook page.
And volunteer. I hope to see you next year at the Creole Fest. Thank you so much. See you next time. Same place. Bye-bye.